You're watching CES Live, powered by Ustream.tv, the most powerful way to stream live video. And by UTech, makers of the TriCaster family of broadcast and streaming systems. And now, CES Live.
Hey everyone, I'm Renee Ritchie and we are back with CES Live. We are wrapping up the day with a bunch of interesting sort of panel-y discussions. We're going to have the Windows Central podcast at 5 o'clock, correct?
Yeah, apparently we do it once a year now, so very flattered.
And we're going to do a panel on mobile trends, and Phil Nickenson from Android Central is showing up.
Or Jordy.
Jordy LaForge from Android Central is showing what's not a trend, it's actually a misuse of being. We have a star-studded panel. We have Daniel Rubino from Windows Central.
Yes. What am I supposed to say something now?
You're supposed to say hello to the chat room, to the audience.
Hello, chat room. Hello, audience.
We only bring him out for the best shows. Phil Nickenson, Android Central.
I'm up all night to get lucky.
Nice.
And Mark, I mean, saying your last name right, Spoonauer.
I don't think I've ever
said it out loud before.
Yeah. Such a great name. I love saying this.
Or you could just say Spoonie, whatever.
Spoonie. Yeah. Tom's Guide, Laptop Mag, all your favorite reviews of all your favorite everythings. So, trends in mobile, I'm going to start with you. I mean, we come to this thing every year. Every year it's 4K. Can we get beyond that? Is there other trends now in mobile?
I think 8K. Bendy. Bendy is a trend.
Stay away from my iPhone.
Yeah. The good kind.
The good kind, yes.
Yeah, I mean, so we saw the Galaxy Note Edge come out with the curved display. Then they actually did something with it in terms of being able to do notifications and application shortcuts on the right-hand side.
Can you bend that for us?
This guy, pop
it down there and
this
push
guy
on.
Is the G Flex 2. It's coming to AT&T and Sprint. And they say it's 30% more durable than the original. And if you try to scratch this up with keys or something else, the self-healing back as opposed to get rid of it within 10 seconds.
Is that using nanites?
I'm not sure what they're using. Yeah.
No, this is perfect for people who actually want to keep their phone in their back pocket, right?
Yeah. 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 I mean, well, and also, I guess it obviates the need for a case. Yeah. Right. Although I don't know how many curved cases you're going to find. Yeah. But, you know,
Sadio will find a way.
Shopandroid.com, ladies and gentlemen. We'll find you one.
Well, Phil, you had one of these when I was with you last year. Mm-hmm. So is this a sign that flexible phones are actually catching on?
I don't know about catching on. I mean, enough so that they're making another one, I think. They must not have lost a whole lot of money on the deal. I love the idea of it. First, it's something different. They've really refined the design this time around, I think.
It's, yeah.
And making it just a little bit smaller. When was the last time?
I think it went from 6 to 5.5. So 5.5 is the new comfortable.
When was the last time a manufacturer listened to us when we said, this is a nice phone, but it's just too big, make it smaller. And usually they go
Nexus
bigger.
Nexus got bigger, right?
Yeah. I mean, this really does, I hate to say feels good in the hand.
Don't do it.
But it does. It fits well. And it really works nicely. I mean, bending is fun. It's not like you have to bend a phone to use it, but it's a nice little safety feature, I think.
And when you hold it up to your head, it actually feels a little more comfortable than your typical
I miss the chins on Android
devices.
It's the
new
Phil,
banana,
it.
Right?
It is the new banana.
Yeah.
So Phil, what are you seeing? What's the trend for you this year? Is it Android on everything, like washing machines, shoes?
It is, and it's a lot like it was last year because Android is open source and anyone can do anything with it for better or worse. And you see better and you see worse, I think.
I saw it in a Bluetooth speaker on, did you see that?
Yeah. And I mean, there's no reason why you shouldn't do all this stuff, and if they do it right and they do it well.
So what's right? What's well?
I mean, this time around, it's been a little more product centric with LG specifically. Yotaphone has a huge presence. If you haven't seen this guy, we just did it on stage a little while ago.
Can you, two sides, two screens?
That's a two-faced phone.
They couldn't make up their mind?
And it's not their first one. This is the Yotaphone 2. But yeah, it's normal Android Super AMOLED on one side, and it's actually pretty stock. And then you flip it over.
And it's a Batman villain.
And it's an e-ink display, you know, low power, relatively high contrast. Yeah. You can read on this thing for days at a time without charging it.
So it looks like a stencil until it moves.
What's really weird is now you have a phone that you're going to put down like that when you're done using it, and you're still going to get information.
What's the response time though, like when you're actually interacting with the back screen?
Let's watch. Okay. So you open it up, and there is a little bit of latency there, like you would expect, right?
It's Kindle fast.
And you do see a tiny little bit of ghosting.
Hashtag Kindle fast. Another one.
It depends on the refresh, but it's crazy and it works.
Is your watch interacting with that phone, Mark?
It's buzzing. I guess someone's trying to give me a call. This is the One Touch watch that's out. $149. It's one of the other trends of this show. I think smartwatches sort of took a back seat this year. I think because fitness trackers are taking over, and they're in the process of sort of merging into this Uber category. But in the meantime, I do think there's a lot of companies that see the Apple Watch coming, and they're like, we got to do something.
Yeah. Including the one that made what looked like an Apple Watch.
Yeah.
Right. Like, so.
Knockoff Alley.
But this one, the OneTouch from Alcatel, what I like about it is the price.
Yep.
You know, $149, you're getting your notifications, you get, you know, fitness features, you can control the camera, you know, whether there's a heart rate monitor, stuff like that.
So what's the deal with Alcatel? Because like someone who's not immersed in Android, it seems like they came out of nowhere to me this year. Like I didn't really hear about them much before this year.
Their parent company is TCL, you know, big Chinese company. Alcatel OneTouch is a name that's been around for a little while, but not necessarily high-end devices, you know, mid-range stuff, more affordable.
They bought the Palm patents, which is what I got.
Yeah, they bought the Palm branding, which is crazy. I mean, they're in Walmart.
Branding, sorry.
They announced today that they're selling directly, I think through themselves, but also through Amazon. I mean, that's a big, big deal. Or Amazon's handling the fulfillment, I guess. So, I mean, they are coming in 2015.
Is that a trend? Because I'm seeing that more. It's like before there was like Huawei and other companies in China, but they were in China. Yeah. And now it feels like they've discovered boats and airplanes.
I had a chance to sit down with Huawei's president not too long ago, and he said that they're going to make a huge push this year to get their phones in the U.S. And I think part of that is the trend is sort of like the carriers are starting to lose some of their power as the prices go down. The sort of this unlocked phenomenon is taking off, and he thinks that there's a lot of room in that like 300 and above range where people finally get the value of phones, like what T-Mobile has done.
Yeah, right, exactly.
Because you're sort of getting rid of the subsidy, people know that they're paying more.
And you're already starting to see that with Samsung struggling on the low to mid end, there's a little bit more. I think HTC has to be really careful, you know, in the
Microsoft
coming year.
And Microsoft is trying to live there comfortably.
All right, so Dan, your trends in mobile this year with your Microsoft band and all your fancy stuff.
Well, you know, the band is still, it's a demonstration device, so it's here, but it's not like the main center. I would still say fitness and that stuff is big, but in terms of pure Windows stuff, you know, it's interesting. Not a revolution, just an evolution of the stuff we have been seeing. So for me, the big deal this year is going to be the new Core I series of chipsets.
Yep.
It's allowing manufacturers just to make some really radically new laptops and tablets that are super thin, super light, powerful.
Right.
It's just really interesting. So.
So is this the year like Intel actually gets mobile?
Yeah, you know, well, I would say actually with Haswell, that was really like the turning point. That was like when we really started getting great, great Ultrabooks. Broadwell, though, just amps it up. I mean, the Dell XPS 13 is what stole the show, I think, for a lot of people.
We actually gave that a Best of Show award.
Yeah, and it has that bezel that's about 0.5 millimeters or something like that.
It's almost no bezel.
Yeah, exactly.
It feels like magic.
Yeah, they worked with Sharp to make this display, and it's just absolutely gorgeous. And everybody wants that, right? Everybody loves that.
How many did you order?
Just one.
But they fit a 13-inch screen into like an 11-inch chassis.
Yeah. Yep.
And I agree, because there's a lot of other devices at this show, and they're making the overt references to the MacBook Air
as if...
And by the way, that was one of the big stories of CES, a rumor that a MacBook, a new 12-inch MacBook is coming.
Yes.
But you had ASUS's chairman on stage make a lot of over comparisons with the Air. He said it's thinner than the Air.
Yeah,
but what I like about it is the detachable nature of it. I feel like the two-in-ones are finally starting to take off. They no longer feel like
I'm so scared I'm going to lose part of it, Mark. I'm going to just attach it, and then I'll be like, I'll have three screens and no keyboards, and I need like a homing device.
Yeah, the two-in-ones like years ago started off, they felt kind of gimmicky and a little clunky, you know, the connectors. But now they're all being refined, they're becoming cleaner, nicer, and you're feeling a lot more natural, not forced.
Yeah.
And because of the extended battery life and the thinness, it makes sense. The Yoga 3 Pro is the first Yoga that, to me, when you actually close it, feels like a tablet now.
Yep.
You know, as opposed to a tablet strapped to a laptop, you know? And so they're making a lot of progress in that regard. And I'm just really excited about all that stuff. I think in, you know, that bezel on the XPS 13, I keep telling people, like, they have an exclusive on that through August of this year. So no one else is going to come out with anything similar. You know, Apple.
Well, no one else with a Sharp unit, right?
Well,
we don't know what Samsung would have up their sleeves.
True. Although I heard Apple now is switching to Sharp. But they won't be able to do anything.
Wow.
Apple kind of makes everyone fight against each other and then uses multiple suppliers.
Well, they'd be smart to use Sharp because that display is really, really.
We asked the guy from Sharp how dense your display is getting. He goes, I can't even count that high.
Yeah.
Like, we're really doing like 9, like 8K, 16K. Like, it doesn't matter anymore. Think about it as paper.
But that's a good question for mobile devices. As when I was talking to Qualcomm, they were saying, oh, well, now that 4K is eventually coming to, you know, smartphones, does it make sense? Or like even with Quad HD, can people tell the difference?
Yeah.
When they're, you know, when they're this small, right?
But it looks good on the box, Mark.
That's exactly what it is. What about the big narrative of the show with the Internet of Things?
IoT. How do you pronounce that?
It's the Internet of Crap. There's so much stuff out there. I don't know what works with what works together, if it'll work well at all.
It's smartphones.
Do my shorts work with my fridge?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. I'm overwhelmed. I don't mind admitting that.
So the problem with the IoT, because I'm a huge fan of this, I have smart things at home. Mm-hmm. I've wired everything up. It's ridiculous. But yeah, so the problem is standards, right? There's a couple floating around out there, but there's no universally agreed one.
Right.
You know, there's still this idea that you have to go buy a thing, bring it home, plug another thing into it, connect to your hub.
You have to do is.
And then an app for everything.
You have to think about it. And it's like a Rube Goldberg. You got to think of how everything's going
to
interact.
We were asking them about, like, we went to a lot of people asking about HomeKit, because that's Apple's attempt to make Sane. And they're like, well, we're looking at HomeKit, but we kind of really want our own thing. And I'm like, yes, so do you, and so does this guy, and so does that. I can't take 19 things. I really can't.
Right.
I want you have your own thing, but also support Apple, also support Google, also support Microsoft, because then I can choose.
It's got to be something like Z-Wave, or something similar, where whatever appliance you buy, a lamp, a refrigerator, it's just going to have this chip in it. You just bring it home, it pops onto your network. Once that happens, that stuff will become a lot more natural.
Great example, Curly.
Right now,
it feels like
smartphones in 2005, 2006, where we were all feeling out form factors, sliders, keyboards,
all this. The slab one, sorry, Dan.
Yeah, and then the slab.
Someone like Lowe's, like if you go to their booth, they have this Iris system, and it has a smart home hub, which is a good idea, and there's all these products that work with it, but then when I ask about Nest, they're like, well, we're talking to them, but they're not. They don't have open APIs.
Well, HomeKit does, and they're still
And Samsung's really opening up SmartThings, which is important. I'm glad they're doing it.
Oh, SmartThings, it was founded as open. So.
So that was another big trend for me this year. Is the interesting case of Android. So you mentioned before you have the Chinese versions of Android coming along. There's still Android open source project. Google's becoming not more controlling, but they're trying to sanitize Android, make it like a better Android experience. Same time, Samsung was on stage with us saying Tizen is the future.
I think you got to back up there. Google is trying to make Google's Android experience better and control that. There is the Google Android experience when you have Google apps and you go through the CTS and all that stuff. And then there's just Android out there in the wild. And that's, I think it's good that there are two. Those are really two different ecosystems at that point.
But Android in the wild can be any of a million different flavors.
It can be insane, yeah. What about the cars? That was kind of the other big thing.
I saw a lot of head units at this show that support both CarPlay and Android Auto, which I think is good, right?
You have to do that. It's so important.
But those things are pretty expensive.
They are.
We were talking about this before. It's like, even though I have a Hyundai that's like 6 or 7 years old, like the most high-tech thing about it is XM radio. And I'm not about to necessarily spend $800 to upgrade it. I feel like most people are going to do it when they get the new car.
Yeah. Well, they kind of have to, because like I have a Toyota right before the year they integrated stuff, and I asked them, can I upgrade? They said, no, buy a new car.
Right.
But the thing I love about this is, so you have basically usually a QNX system that's running it. So if I just have a regular phone, I can attach to it. But if I have an iPhone or an Android phone, I get an Android or an iPhone experience. And I don't want to upgrade my car every year, but I'm going to upgrade my phone, I'm going to upgrade my OS, and that will make my car better now. And that to me, I have all my stuff on here. It's either on the device or on the cloud or both. And if I can just have that project into my car, project into my house.
But they're not going
so
that way.
Better.
You know what's happening? We're seeing the same thing in cars as we did with US carriers. The cars are teaming up with the carriers. They want to control the experience.
Yep.
And they want their own system in there. They don't want, I mean, that's why
AT&T. They do have CarPlay and Android in there.
But AT&T is trying to do their own thing too.
I think they're afraid. I think the car makers are afraid of wresting control or having it wrested from them. From the CarPlay and Android Auto. Yeah. But what I do like, a sign of progress, is with like something like the Ford Sync 3.0, is that you will be able to upgrade it. You don't have to take it into the shop necessarily to upgrade. I think that's a huge step forward.
Yeah, it's going to take a couple iterations, I think some negative pushback, some positive feedback before we settle on, because I'd like that experience too, but right now I feel like it's going to sort of opposite direction.
And Microsoft's a huge cloud company. I mean, that's one of the, like, from my Xbox to my Windows phone to my Windows laptop. I can be a person and not have to worry about maintaining all these separate things.
Yeah, everybody's doing that now with the cloud stuff. You know, there's almost too much choice in cloud, so it's like, where do you go?
How many clouds do you have, Phil?
Too many. I've been staring at this thing for like 10 minutes
now. So tell us, what is this
I know
thing?
It's wearing it. What is it, Mark? I'll model it for you.
I had a briefing with these guys yesterday, and it's a wearable display, but it also has headphones built in, and this is the first time that they're debuting the consumer design. So what we're looking at here, this the micro mirror optics on the inside, it's supposed to project what's supposed to be an 80-inch display in your field of vision.
Wow.
And I got a demo yesterday of a sort of that's not as cosmetically beautiful as this, but it worked. And I had it tied into my iPhone via HDMI.
So is that a trend now? Because Oculus got bought by Facebook. We've seen Samsung do theirs. We've seen other players. You had someone at the booth the other day, Phil, who was doing a really small version of this. Mm-hmm. Is VR a trend yet, or is it still coming?
I think everybody's toeing the water a little bit, and Samsung's really putting a whole leg in with Gear VR. And if you haven't tried Gear VR, absolutely do it, because it's fascinating.
Yeah.
It's not as good as Oculus. It's not as expensive, and it needs as much headroom as Oculus. Mm-hmm. But from a mobile perspective, I think they've done something really, really interesting there.
Yeah, and it's almost a shame that it's called Innovator Edition, because it's like scaring people off. It's like you might not.
It's like Explorer
ready.
Glasses, right?
Yeah. Right. But I think like the Milk VR is a step in the right direction. That what they need is the content. With something like this, you're just going to plug it in via HDMI to your tablet or your phone or your Xbox, and you'll be able to play games and movies and stuff. So it's really more like sort of additive. But it's not cheap. It's going to be like $499 through, I think, January 15th, and then $599 after that. So if you want a combination headphone, heads-up display, you have to be willing to pay for it. But at least I think it's a step in the right direction. I would wear this on the plane. Maybe I wouldn't wear it on the subway.
Well, you know,
just begging for something.
You take them off and suddenly you're sitting there naked.
No, but they have a promotional video where there's someone like, you know, they're wearing it on the subway, and I would not be that person.
And when you take them off, that's all you're wearing.
But if I'm on the plane, I would do it because.
Yeah,
no
what's
going to
happen
care.
On a plane?
No.
Sure, right.
So, I mean, we talked about content a little bit, and I made a joke about 4K. You know, every year we come to CES, it's 4K. Now we have 4K, we have Beyond 4K, we have SUHD, we have 8K, and we have an announcement that there's finally going to be a Blu-ray 4K HDR standard.
So I want to kind of talk about that, because that stuff is kind of annoying, right? And you brought this up with the 4K, and at a certain point, can you not tell the difference anymore? And it was funny, I was hanging out with Dolby yesterday. And so they're doing a couple interesting things. They have Dolby Atmos, which right now is in cinemas, and it's coming to home and mobile this year. They also have Dolby Vision. So what they're doing, they're kind of getting away from the spec thing.
Yeah.
So instead of just focusing on 4K, they want to make the best 4K. So they have their own standards that they're doing. It's an extra layer that goes into the processing. And so the whites are perfectly white and all the color balance, and they work with the studios to make this content. They create a one master sheet, and then it could go out to all the media channels. It's coming to cinema, home, and all that. And same with the sound. So what was the most annoying thing about Dolby sound? 5.1, 7.1,
7.2.
Yeah, it kept getting ridiculous. And it was like, at what point does it end? Well, Atmos gets around that by all you need is 5 channels, but you can go up to something like 30. And what it is, it's a dynamic system. As a single channel feed that comes in, you tell it how many speakers you have, and it creates the sound system based off of that for your specific room.
That makes sense.
And that's a smart thing, right? This is now taking what was a...
So can you do that for like TVs? Can we have like 4K, 16K, 30? I don't need to have any K. You have two sets of eyes, I'm beaming stuff right into there.
But that's why, like, when it comes down to it, when people go by like LG's booth or Sony's or whatever, they care about the picture quality and the color quality, which is why you're seeing like quantum dot technology. I'd love to see a quantum dot display on it.
So I'm not certain about what quantum dot means.
Would not surprise me.
Well, I think it's. I have to ask our TV editor more about that, but it really gets down to having the most realistic color reproduction possible on a panel and closest to real life as possible without
increasing
as much
the
calibration
color gamut,
as you used to have to do.
Sure, yeah.
And I think that's annoying for a lot of people. But what's sort of ironic about 4K is that mobile is driving a lot of the growth, because people are allowed to sort of capture their own videos in 4K, and it's sort of like ahead of
it
the content.
It's 4K now.
Yeah, it's ahead of like where the content industry is.
Lumia 930 with the Denim update. And if you just hold down the camera button, it automatically starts shooting a 4K video. And because 4K video is so powerful, you can then go back into that video, pull out still frames, and save those as individual 8 megapixel photos.
Right.
And so, you know, you capture everything all at once. So, just to show you.
You just need to go for the 128 gig version of whatever you're buying.
Yeah,
and
seriously.
Then you'll be fine.
You got a couple minutes of video that way.
Right.
Well, I mean, we have a technology, like they're going to go with H.265, HEVCA. Eventually, so that should help with some of that compression. You love that, don't you? HEVCA, what the best acronym of the year award.
The codecs and standard stuff, that's like, you need a PhD to understand
all that. I make fun of you because I every year you get a ridiculous phone. Like a phone that just, it's either it's like an 8K display or it's got like a speaker on like on every edge of the device or something. It always seems like there's someone who just wants to push the envelope.
That's a good thing. I think that's absolutely a good thing, because that's how you end up with phones that, you know, bend if you sit on them. And this crazy e-ink thing. And at the same time, that allows other players like Motorola to pare back and say, all right, here's this Moto X that we're going to make a really simple experience out of it. We're going to do some other fun stuff. You can
is that rawhide, Phil?
This is
beef jerky.
It is not the beef jerky phone. Yeah, I think it's the mahogany color.
Yeah, it looks
I'm trying to remember. Not bourbon. There's some other name. But yeah, I mean, you get to do cool things like that, but with simple experiences, and they've done pretty well for themselves.
Yeah, I like the trickle-down effect of innovation because sure. if you fail at something once, or it just doesn't take off as much as you hope, then you build it into the next version.
Like hardware keyboards.
We tend to have such short-term memory with all this stuff, and this phone didn't work, the company is doomed. Well, no, because they're working 2, 3, 4 years at a time on this stuff.
I am interested to see what Lenovo does with Motorola.
Yep.
I want to see how they use that as a brand in the U.S.
And what happens to Motorola in the short term? Are they going to disappear for a couple years like they did initially under Google and go back underground and back to the drawing board? I don't know.
So the platforms, for years it was the platform wars. You know, it was almost like the early days of the UFC. It was like Kung Fu versus Karate. Right. And now everyone seems to be bringing their A game. We talked about this last year, but this year more than ever, across this table, there's really no bad devices anymore. What are consumers going to do, Phil? How are they going to decide what they're going to buy?
AndroidCentral.com. That's why I'm here. There are still some bad devices out there. Not as many as there used to be. And the lower end, what we would traditionally call a bad device, or really just something we didn't care about because it wasn't as sexy as something else, those have all gotten better as well. Once everyone realized, all right, we need to do low to mid-enders, at least from a price standpoint,
but we need to
do them well.
I think it's also because OEMs like Samsung have pared back the number of devices that they're flooding the market with. I mean, granted, I think we're going to do, like, instead of 150, we're going to do 50 or something like that.
Still a lot, but...
You can't go cold turkey when it comes to Samsung. But I think that's a good sign in terms of like having like a simpler, good, better, best strategy for some of these guys.
We were at, I think it was Showstoppers, and there was a piece of paper on the table that said Microsoft Nokia phone or something, $29. With a keyboard. It looked like it had a T9 keyboard.
Yeah, we got to still post that video up with that. But yeah, so that's still a continuation of Nokia stuff. It's a $29 phone. It doesn't run Windows.
I can't get dinner in Vegas for $29.
Yeah, it goes to show you just how far this technology, you know, used to trickle down, is coming down. It's actually really nice. It's got a color display on it, not touch, but you can use the menu controls. For $29, this is for emerging markets, right? No one in the U.S., this is going to be sold here. It's meant for countries where they don't really have cell phones yet, or it's still a new thing. It's more than something that can make calls. It runs apps. It can do stuff, you know?
It can get on Facebook.
And that's so important. Talking about Facebook, right? Zuckerberg's been big on this, getting internet to the people who just don't have it yet, because what drives the internet is people being on it. This is why I criticize the Apple model. If we only had the Apple model, no one would have computers. We wouldn't have half the stuff because of the affordability thing, right? It's all about pushing, like, one of the biggest stories this year, I thought, was Microsoft and Toshiba selling, the HP Stream, Stream. Was it 100? Yeah, $179. Now it's a $179 laptop. It's tiny, it's 11 inches, and it's actually cool looking, though. It's this awesome blue. But $179 laptop, and it's not crap. I mean, it's actually a really nice device.
That's actually the slogan.
It's not crap. Yeah, so it's like...
Hashtag, it's not crap.
But like being able to sell a $179 laptop, that means a lot to a lot of people. Yeah, maybe not to anyone up here.
That's the one laptop for child dream, right?
Yeah, pretty much. I mean, it really opens a lot of doors because that kid who gets that allows them to move up and go into that world, that's so important.
What do you think about that versus Chromebooks, though? Because I think Microsoft is a little bit nervous about their momentum.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting. It's like if you have all these kids who are going into schools and they're getting Chromebooks, what are they going to buy when they graduate?
Sure. Right? So, I don't think the threat from Chromebooks is real today. I think the possibility of it is definitely there.
Right.
And so, like, we haven't seen Chromebooks, like, catch on as a thing yet.
No.
But the possibility of it is definitely looming.
Right.
And so I think Microsoft but we're getting ahead of
this.
Windows 8.1, everything works very well on low spec devices. And so they can actually put a full OS now on something with lower processing speeds. And so I think they're actually kind of getting ahead of this, is why we're selling a flood. I mean, they're selling little $79 and $99.
This is what I love so much. So Windows Central, Android Central, Phil will post about a phone, they'll go, only 3 gigabytes of RAM, only this processor, and on Windows Central, they'll be like, it works with 512.
Yeah.
And like, they're like, yay!
Oh, right, yeah, sure. Yeah, that's
Didn't definitely we see good. The first 4 gigabyte phone here from Asus?
I think we did, yeah.
Yeah. Do you think that's going to do anything when it gets here, the Zen phone too?
It really depends on their marketing. Yeah. I mean, they do a lot of really good products.
Right.
Phones haven't really gotten much push in the U.S.
No, so other than AT&T, right?
Yeah.
And they
but even then, it took forever.
And they had that weird hybrid, the phone that plugs into the tablet that no one bought.
Oh, right.
iPhone
X. Yeah.
So we mentioned the Internet of Things casually, but I mean, that is a huge term. It's almost everything is connected. We had the health and fitness product. We had the connected devices. I have Hue lights. You know, I think you have Sonos
I have Hue lights.
Yeah, you have Hue lights.
I got 12 of them. I went all in.
It seems like the entertainment stuff is what gets you in the door, but then there really are like locks for your house.
I got
the thermometer. You can start adding more and more stuff to it, but then now we have toys. I mean, drones are controlled by our smartphones.
Sure. Google Cast for speakers this week is a big deal. I'm not sure if Sonos needs to worry just yet because it's very different products.
Right.
But yeah, being able to seamlessly, like we talked about earlier, seamlessly connect these things some way, somehow, is a huge deal. That's why when I hear Internet of Things, it makes me sound like they just don't know what they're talking about yet.
It's a catch-all.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean anything.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
So the drone, Serenity and I were just in Sands, and they were 3D printing drones. What were I? So part of me thinks that's fantastic. I can sit there with a 3D printer out of Star Trek, make a little shuttlecraft, have it go off. One of the people who was standing there was like, "Yeah, I was on a yacht the other day with three women in a bikini, and there was drones just flying over the boat constantly."
Yep, right.
I mean, we're starting to have to talk more about ethics and technology.
No,
as
we
well
don't.
Now.
I want that thing in Prometheus that does the surgery. I want to be able to go all out partying, come home, 3D print a liver, go into this machine, have it insert, get up, go. That's gonna be great, man.
Yeah, I think you need hate the term disruptors, but I think you need the disruptors, and you also need that other end pulling back, so we end up somewhere
because
closer
it starts
to the
conversation.
Yeah.
Like there was this, I think it's called Nexi. Did you guys see this drone at the Intel booth?
Yes. Yeah.
So the idea is so it's on your wrist. It's a wearable drone, and with a sort of with a gesture, it flies off of your wrist, goes out, takes your picture, and then flies back to
your
hand.
It's a selfie drone.
So I was like, if I took this to my kid's soccer game, I think parents would probably run in fear.
Mm-hmm. For
right?
Sure.
So, but if you don't do these things, then we don't talk about the
issue. The only way you know about boundaries is
you smash them, right?
I do it every day. So.
Yeah, but I mean, last year we talked a lot about kids and technology and making them aware of all these things. My godchildren, they have Hue lights too, but they're not allowed to have their devices all the time because their parents think it's going to rot their brain. But they have one of those little Hue taps, and they have three choices that they can do on their Hue. Once a week, they can reprogram them. But every night, but it's like you have daughters. These are daughters are entering a world where there's a drone up there with a video camera.
It scares the hell out of me.
My
8-year-old does things, on her tablet. I'm not entirely. I started playing Clash of Clans because she plays it. I wanted to know what it was.
Yeah.
It brought us together.
I saw one company who was demoing a kid tracker for within 200 feet or something like that. So they're at the playground and they sort of go wandering off. A part of me says that's neat. The other part of me says, look.
Well, I mean, we did a Life 360. We did a story on that recently, and that's a real interesting company. I thought, it's a free product. They have a way that you can do a pro version, but it's a way for families to track their kids, and it's not as weird as you should know where your kid is at a playground.
Right.
But I like that idea of for families with kids, when they check in at home and you get that notification.
Yep.
And I think that's a real interesting use of Internet of Things and Connect.
Yeah, we had someone on the stage who said that, they're a version of a thermometer that can keep track of where you are in the rooms. And and they were out of town and suddenly it showed the people in the room getting higher and higher and higher. And he called and goes, "Are you having a party?" "No, I swear." He's "There's 13 people in that room."
So also, the music's really loud.
Seriously. Yeah, and the cops just called.
It could be 3, I believe, came out last September, but it's like Nest, but it actually has sensors. And it comes with a sensor, but you can add multiple sensors. And they go into your different rooms, and they detect, when you're in the room, and adjust the temperature, and then it gives you a smarter control of the temperature in your house. And for me, I have a Nest right now, and I like it a lot, but then I heard about the Ecobee, and I'm like, oh, that's smarter. it's kind of cool to see how this stuff is sort of evolving.
Well, there's a dark side. It went by in the chat room, and I forget the name, I apologize, but someone was saying, Google Glass was a big thing, and this year I don't hear about it.
No,
Can we listen to this tech? Yeah. We'll talk about it here, but it will even be a thing next year? I think some people are feeling burnt by how fast technology comes in and then disappears from their lives.
Well, smartwatches, I think, is kind of like that, right? It was a big thing a year ago. This year, it's still here, but it's a little bit team.
It's a wait and see mode, though, with the Apple Watch. I feel like people are going to see, like, does it resonate? Too. Is the price point
But even the Apple Watch, it's only going to be useful to people with an iPhone. And there's going to be a huge market. Like Phil might think it's great, but it's not usable with an Android
phone.
The
Apple Watch has a certain level of guaranteed success because it's an Apple product.
Right,
And it's this closed ecosystem. Cool, we know how many are out there. But yeah, I mean, look how early we are. We have 6 Android Wear watches in 6 months.
You got six generations of Galaxy watches.
Yeah, I mean, and look how far
running 3 different operating systems.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's and there's the bubble of what we talk about here.
There's also still that battery technology limitation that we're all
facing. So should people wait? Yeah. I mean, like, should you want to be a Google Glass Explorer? Should you want to get those speakers as soon as they come out, get onto wearables immediately? Or if you're just, like, watching a show like this, is it better for you to wait a generation, two generations, and see if it becomes a big deal?
Depends on your disposable income.
it really does. There's absolutely nothing wrong with getting Google Glass because you thought it was cool. One of our guys here is wearing it.
Yeah. Right.
And if you use it so much, the better. If it doesn't pan out, it doesn't pan out.
Just don't use it in a bar.
Don't use it in a bar. Don't look at my kids.
You'll be discriminated against.
But we have this, I call it, you know, it's the Segway effect. The Segway was going to revolutionize society as we know it.
Example. Yeah.
Let's cut down on the rhetoric a little bit and you know, use these devices and push how we use them, but you do have to have a little patience and let it pan out.
But I do think that there is a social stigma attached to wearable cameras.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Oh, yeah.
Regardless of what form it comes in, it could be clipped here or on your glasses.
Yep.
You know, what I liked about Sony's booth is that they had a wearable glasses, but it was it's a concept, but it's very specific for sports. So if I'm at the golf course and it's communicating with my phone, I hold up 2 golf clubs, it tells me which one to use. Hmm. Or if I'm on a run, it actually says, you know, go this way or that way, but it's in your peripheral vision.
Yeah.
So that's like a clever use for wearables, but it's for a specific niche.
Sure.
So another dark side we saw this year was all the hacks. We put more of our credit card information online. Target, Home Depot got hacked.
Right.
Celebrities put pictures online, they got hacked. Sony executives, they put email, you know, they probably didn't want anybody to see it online. It got hacked. We're putting more and more information on the cloud, on our devices, and that makes it accessible to people who don't want to do nice things with
it. I have the answer. Let's just go back to flip phones.
Yes.
I was saying smoke signals, but I like the idea.
Here's what is going to change. I told this to Sasha Pallenberg a couple years ago, maybe in Barcelona. It's only when our search histories get leaked will we care. Right now, it's just it's a minor inconvenience for us. Our bank has to send us a new credit card. The banks lose money on it. On
well,
the deal.
Because maybe no one was interested in publishing our photos, Phil, quite frankly.
Right, but no, it's not until really embarrassing things like that happen to mom and dad, and happen to you and me, and literally, I think it's the search history. When that happens, then we're going to get serious about it.
Do you think we're on the road to that?
I hope not, but we might well be.
Oh.
On the other hand, people could just quit doing this and not, you know, don't be evil about it, and life will go on.
Well, I mean, that's what happened with the Xbox hack and the PlayStation hack on Christmas Eve. Like, and I probably should have taunted hackers, but I thought it was a little silly too. At the same time, I was like, oh no, I can't play a video game today. Like, because you knew this wasn't going to last 6 weeks, but it was just like.
Okay, so no, I understand your point, but there's something to be said for companies that, for whether it's for anti-piracy, for other reasons, try to force you to play online when the game doesn't necessarily require it or could have a mode that's offline as well. And suddenly you can't play your game because the system is down, but you own that game. Like, it's yours. You should be able to play it anyway.
Sure. Is it because they want to authenticate it and make sure that it's, like, yours?
EA had that with The Sims, right, where they put it out and it was just copy pastes, all it was, and their servers couldn't handle it and nobody could play the game they bought.
I think it's also, I mean, that's an interesting question, but I think, you know, at least with the Xbox, a lot of stuff is tied in. Like, you could tell it to record it and it shares the clip. You have your achievements and, you know, people logged in and doing multiplayer. You know, the games and the systems themselves have become driven to be connected devices. And a lot of games are just connected by nature. But, I mean, it's an interesting question about, I think, and I don't know this too much because I don't game as much as I should, but
there's a level of gaming you're not reaching.
Some of us need to go outside and walk. Some of us need to game more.
But I think some games can do that, but I don't know the parameters around them.
Yeah, but it does. Like, you raise an interesting point, and I had this experience previously. Like, you know, like when the power goes out and you suddenly, like, can I still rub 2 sticks together to make fire? And there's this feeling now, we lived in villages, we lived on farms, we knew our neighbors, we all moved to the city, and we didn't know the people around us. But now we have these phones that are always connected. And like, Phil and Dan and I live in totally different parts of the world, but we're together every day, all day. They're my village. And when I lose my internet connection, my community is gone.
Right.
And that, to me, that happened to me this year, and it really changed my perspective. So I felt alone and abandoned, as if like my entire community had run away all of a sudden. And that was a real, I was not anticipating that.
You gotta learn to enjoy it.
I was gonna say,
that's
I,
what
I,
we we used to do during hurricanes down in Florida.
It's like when you're on a, when you're on the plane flight out here, there was no internet, and they kept apologizing for it. But part of me was like,
I don't,
that's okay.
I'm one of those people
like
that, like, when I travel, I don't do this work travel thing. You know, like, I know I can work on the plane with Wi-Fi, but I'm like, no, it's just not ideal for me. I'm not buying into that. For some people, that's
I'm
okay.
I'm just going to tune out.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Another thing that was sort of a trend this year was the absence of tablets. I mean, with the notable exception of Dell, many people said that, you know, tablets, I think 1 year Phil got off the plane and five tablets had been announced. And then this year, people are like, where are all the tablets? Are they, the phones have gotten bigger, which is putting pressure from underneath, but the laptops are getting thinner and lighter, and they're putting pressure from on top.
I would say, I think the major manufacturers have scaled back their tablets. I mean, you can walk out there and see a million tablets made by a million companies, but the major players have said, all right, we're kind of settling down now on what it is we want, what it is consumers want, and we're going to focus more on that and make the experience better. I think Dell's done something really special.
I mean,
here,
this Venue 8 7000 series, I mean, it has an awesome display, one of the best that I've seen on a tablet.
Yep.
And, you know, super thin bezels, and it also has three cameras on the back that could be used for depth sensing using the RealSense technology from Intel. But I think a lot of people are just going to pick it up just because it's sexy. But we're still going to do the full review, but
they did an awesome job
in the design.
We're seeing the return of Atom, really, to mobile. And
And
what's Atom, Phil?
Atom is, when I hear Atom, I still think netbook, even in my head, even though I know better.
I think about the little DC Comics character. So. But it's Intel's mobile.
It's Intel's mobile processor,
And it's inside that new Asus phone, too, the Zen phone, too. I mean, granted, they have not had a lot of success in the U.S., but they're starting to make some inroads.
Oh, and the Toshiba tablet we just had up here before was Atom. There's a lot of like Windows tablets now that use it, too. And they're pretty powerful. You'd be surprised. I mean, you can run full Windows 8.1 on an Atom processor and a little teeny tablet. It's like, it's just kind of weird.
I think there are marketing issues there that they need to work on. And Snapdragon's just a sexy name. So, Snapdragon Atom.
You remember last year we had Ryan Biden from Samsung on here with like three new tablets, all announced, maybe four, all announced that day.
Right.
This year we didn't really.
I actually tweeted a couple nights ago. I said the dirty word at CES is tablets. Like no one's talking about it, and I think part of it is the phablet. Phones are getting bigger, but I think the two-in-ones are getting more compelling.
Right.
And I think people are also waiting for a bigger iPad Pro-like device. I think that the 13-inch that Lenovo had, it's wild and crazy, the one that has a built-in projector.
But
I brought that home for the kids, and I like put it on the wall, and they're like, oh, awesome, I don't have to watch the crappy selection of movies that I have you make us watch over and over again. But at least there's innovation going on the bigger tablets. I think people are trying to figure out, where does this fit between my phone and my laptop?
And this doesn't compete with the Surface, I don't think, especially because of Android. Android's just not in that same
OS,
space.
You know, it's weird, because like, I got the iPhone 6 Plus, which is 5.5 inches. I don't use my iPad mini anymore, but I do use my iPad Air more. I was just using a mini. I didn't even bring my mini with me for the plane. I just used this because it was big enough. And I think, I wonder if the pressure from bigger phones will mean bigger tablets and then like an iMac. Like, will you be someone who has the smallest of everything or the biggest of everything?
But you can't just go bigger, because we're seeing that. You see that with the Nexus 9. I can use it. It's a perfectly functioning tablet, but it stops there. You look at something like the Surface Pro, that it's really close to tablet, but does so much more.
Yeah, I mean, I have quite a few tablets. I have the Dell Venue 8. I have.
You have one of each, Dan.
I do. I just, actually, I had the Lenovo ThinkPad 8, which is kind of hard to find now. But I realize it's like an amazingly powerful tablet. It's really got some cool innovation in it. But tablets for me, I mean, and I have a unique lifestyle, obviously, with job and everything. But I like using, my Lumia 1520 with a 6-inch screen or a Surface. You know, I don't need anything in between. It doesn't fit, right? Because the keyboard with the Surface, I could just, boom, type out.
Well, that was Derek Kessler's most famous tweet ever, where he did every Samsung screen size. And at one point, he couldn't fit him in a tweet anymore.
Yep.
But they had literally everything at a quarter-inch size, and we don't really see that anymore either.
It was a lost leader to feel out the market and figure out what to
do. They could afford to do that at that time, and I feel like that time has passed.
Yes.
Sure.
Right. But I do think that we're in 2015, we're going to see more big screen tablets for the very reason that smartphones do enough in terms of media consumption and also starting in terms of productivity.
Sure.
Yep.
Yeah.
You know, as the screens get a little bit bigger, bigger keyboards, I make a lot less typos on the Note 4 than I do on the S5.
Yeah.
It's a huge difference.
Yeah. Yeah, when you go on to a 6-inch, you go landscape, it's almost too big.
Yep,
it's
like
right.
Yeah, so Phil, I mean, like you get, again, every phone at every screen size. Are you gravitating towards the bigger device? I see you with the Moto X, or not the Nexus 6.
That was my big sticking point this year, was the Moto X. I preferred the smaller one, I thought. I still use this one perfectly fine. What is this, 5 inches, I think?
Right.
But I tell you, this Yotaphone, feels really nice. And again, big screens, but the design makes a big difference. So it really is something for everybody at this point.
That's one of the things I noticed is for a while, like even as we're talking about 5.5 or 4.7 inches, and people don't talk about the casing size, because you can have two phones with 5-inch screens, one is a behemoth, one I could drop on the ground and break them.
I would actually argue that the case size of this is too tall. Yeah. The iPhone, yeah. The iPhone 6 Plus.
Shoot those real quick and you see the big
difference.
And
that's a 5-inch.
Right?
Yeah.
Can you grab those, Dan?
And those are relatively similar screen
sizes.
There's
a fair amount of wasted space because of this button, and I know people appreciate the
tactile
feel.
Well, yeah, so there's two things. One is the escape hatch, yeah, but also they went all in with Touch ID on the button, and so until Touch ID moves to the screen, you got to have enough room for the button, and then you got to have the same amount of room.
Which was a rumor for the iPhone 6, but didn't. Yeah. Like a lot of other rumors didn't come true.
Yeah.
Well, like one of the things is rumors, and you know, you guys have all spoken to manufacturers. Like they said, they work 2-3 years out. So it's a rumor, but is it a rumor for this year, for next year, for the other year? Is it one of three prototypes they're working on, and that prototype just never makes it in? Like the rumor game, Tim Cook famously said, you can't take one data point and make an educated guess about it.
Right. Right. Well, liquid metal was another thing that was a rumor, right?
My SIM ejector button dongle is still working great, but that's it, right?
Right. Yeah.
Sapphire screens. Yep. Yeah, I mean, like, there's reasons that didn't happen, but it's really, so that's a great staging point. Phil, where are we going this year?
I'm hoping just for better experience, and I think we're getting there. I really do. The hardware has kind of sussed itself out a little bit. I mean, that's not to, we talk about the plateau,
right?
But that's from a technological standpoint, and that's not to say that they're still not advancing, still not doing things better. They are.
Right.
But from a consumer experience standpoint, Snapdragon 801 is pretty much the same thing as 805 or 800, even with 810 coming out.
But 810?
Out.
Yeah. Same thing?
4K holographic screens?
My mom's not gonna notice the difference in what she does.
No.
So
no, but the residual effects of it, like you can put some really high megapixel. I mean, I'm hoping.
For specific use cases, yes.
Yeah, Snapdragon 810, maybe a Lumia 1030.
Well, but to Phil's point, and we saw this, right? Like people are saying the iPad sales, for example, are plateauing. Are they plateauing, or just for a normal person, the device they bought a year ago or 2 years ago is still fine?
Well, that was the deal with laptops, supposedly.
Yeah, it's the replacement cycle, right? For laptops, it's extended to 4 or 5 years because of the good enough.
Yeah.
What's interesting, what Intel told us about 2-in-1s is that it's twice as fast.
Oh, is it?
For people who buy those
devices. Lose the keyboards, like me. I'm telling you.
But for me, like one of the big trends of this year, continuing from 2014, is the affordability factor.
Yeah.
So getting high-end specs, it's the sort of the Xiaomi effect, right?
Yeah.
Extending to the US as well. So to the ability to get high-end specs at an affordable price without a contract gets more people into the mix, which I think is a great thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right, so Mark, what are you looking forward to this year?
I'm looking forward to virtual reality done right.
You know,
so I'd love to see the Galaxy Note 4, and when I get back from CES, I'm going to be playing around with the Gear VR. I want to see them open that up to more phones and get more content on board. I probably tested out like 5 or 6 headsets at the show, and I'm probably going to stop wearing hair gel, because what's the point? but I love the fact of that all these companies are trying, and by this time next year, I think there's going to be a lot more content in place.
Sure.
Dan, what are you looking forward to?
Two things. I want more Internet of Things, but I want it to be...
Someone send him a box of Internet of Things.
No, but I want it to be distilled, right? I want standards. I want the idea of like more continuity. I want it to come together so it doesn't feel as chaotic and as, you know, it's niche right now. The only people doing it are early adopters, and it's something that's going mainstream, but I think it's going to take a few years. But I also want better displays, not in terms of resolution. I want bezel-less, like the XPS 13, I want that in mobile too. It's the one thing I always hear about people is what we were talking about before with the iPhone. People want that edge-to-edge display.
They want that phone from like Avatar or from Iron Man, where it's just a clear piece of plastic.
Actually, Samsung was showing off, not prototypes, but the fake movie stuff the other night.
Oh, yeah.
It was fun
to
see.
Yeah, Panasonic was showing off like those walls, those glass walls that you could actually have displays inside. It's coming, Dan, the future's coming.
Yeah, it's just a matter of, you know, obviously they break easier, and so they're hard to make.
You can't sit on the glass phone.
Yeah.
Renee, what do you want to see from Apple this year?
The thing with Apple is that, you know, they're pretty consistent. As much as people say they're mysterious, there'll be a new iPhone, there'll be a new iPad, there'll be an Apple Watch, there'll be new Macs. The question is, what problems are they going to solve? Like, I think Apple Pay solved a really, like, as a Canadian, I've always been appalled. I come here, I tap my card, and people say, what the hell are you doing?
I'm appalled when I go to Europe and they expect me to tap my card. Like, what do you mean?
I want to see that technology, and whether it's Google Wallet or Apple Pay, I want to see that technology put out. Like I said, CarPlay. I want to be able to just bring my phone into a rental car and have my all my stuff just show up there. Mm-hmm. I want to eventually have camera play and fridge play and all these things. I think that there's a whole world of, like you said, the experience where they can say that, you know, you have your stuff and we're going to make the best experience possible for you on our stuff, on our screens. And then I want some high dynamic range, so the color gamut, you know, kind of pushes out.
I want better cameras in 2015, damn it. That's what I want for Android.
Yeah. We're almost there. Yeah. There's a lot of people, even at this show, who are using smartphones as their primary camera, and you even had Panasonic show up, the Lumix phone.
Yep.
Yeah. Granted, it's like, what, $1,000?
A lot of money, yeah.
But we're getting there, and I think this... pretty soon we're going to get rid of like mirrorless cameras and maybe carry these instead.
Sure.
Yeah, what I'm curious about is that cameras like depth and smartphone makers want to make thin phones, and those are like two tensions. And either they'll go, like I have a Lumia 1020 at home, and that's got an alien face hugger on the back with a lens on it.
Right.
And that's a
and
compromise
it's still
I need
remarkable
to have.
Though.
But I need that big lens to get that kind of good quality glass. Some people are doing remote viewfinders where you have the camera, but you can see it on your smartphone and use that as a viewfinder. It's going to be interesting to see how they solve the big glass on thin phone sort of problem.
Well, the 1020 solved one problem, which was not having a giant zoom lens.
Yes.
You know, that's why it was a 41 megapixel sensor, so you can crop the zoom instead. So they solved that problem that way. But yeah, sure, you still had that little bump on the back, so that needs to get thinner. And I'm sure, you know, we're all expecting a 1030 this year, and I'm sure when that happens that they will have solved that a little bit.
I'm surprised that no one else went that route. I mean, we've seen like 20 megapixel sensors.
Yeah, yeah.
Most people are using Sony's sensor for their cameras, but I haven't seen a lot of other people try to solve the problem in the same way.
Yeah, yeah. It's interesting.
They probably see it, they saw the 1020 coming and said, you guys got that. We're fine. Yeah. We'll put two cameras, one on top of each other.
Right.
Well, HTC experiment, everyone's experimenting slightly differently, and like now I have optical image stabilization in here. Yeah. So it seems like at least the experiment, some people stumble, they fall down. They get up, we get great new technology.
And it's going to be really interesting, specifically HTC, to see what they do in 2015 as they expand from the smartphone space. They're not giving it up, they're not stopping,
right.
But they're getting into these other interesting...
The Re camera?
Yeah, the Re camera is just the beginning. The partnership with Under Armour the other day. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to see some really interesting things from them in 2015.
So HTC is a company to watch?
Always have been, haven't they?
So, they've always been interesting.
I love them since the Trio Pro. Make me another Trio Pro. Apparently, you can get the you can get the trademarks real easy.
Disco keyboard.
And any other companies we should pay attention to this year, Mark?
Palm?
No.
No.
Derek Kessler almost jumped out of it.
I know. Flashback.
I show you a watch.
Yeah, I do think that in terms of just general trends, I'd love to see more intelligence being put into devices and wearables, and when you walk into the house, having them interact with your smart home.
Sure.
There's like Oki Doki company that I saw where they have, it's very simple, but it's an NFC tag that you wear so that when you get to your house, it unlocks the door automatically. So how can the smart home and wearables interact in a more natural way? That's what I'm looking forward to.
Sure.
I'm hoping, like this was my dream last year, I didn't get it, I'm hoping for this year. I want to be able to come to CES and have beacons tell me, oh, there's a parking space available here, direct me to it, come out. You're supposed to be in South Hall, the beacons bring me to South Hall, I come here, I put my phone down, there's a display or tablet, suddenly all my stuff is on that display or tablet. I decide I'm going to leave, it starts the coffee at my house, it starts the oven warming up, and then it says, oh, by the way, idiot, you forgot the milk yesterday, you better pick it up on the way home tonight, or you're going to, you know.
It's about anticipatory intelligence.
Contextual aware, it's not Terminator, it's not, you know, the Matrix, it's contextual awareness that just helps us lead better lives.
Yeah, I don't want my smartphone to remind me
about something I told it
to remind me. You know, that's,
well,
that's
think
nice,
where,
but I want it to read my emails.
So you want Cortana for the fridge.
Yeah, well, I mean, the idea of I want something to tell me stuff I didn't think about.
Yeah.
It. I
don't
know.
Is the Google Now sort of thing.
You want Google Now. Yeah.
Yeah.
I know a guy.
So here's the thing with Google Now, and we've talked about this before. I got the Nexus 5 last year, and I turned it on, and said, you want to use Google Now? And I'm like, hell yes. And it says, can we monitor all your web history? And I said, hell no. And it goes, sorry, you can't have Google Now. And I'm like, that was a very binary thing, because I just, as a privacy person, I was just like, I didn't want to share that, and now I can't have Google. And like, I think we need to be better about explaining to regular people, you know, why we're asking for what we're asking for, how we're using it. It's not scary. This is the benefits that you get from it. Because all the stuff, Ford told us this years ago. They said, you know, we could have self-driving cars, but people would be scared out of their minds. We got to make sure we do one feature every year and slowly integrate it into their lives.
Sort of iterate, I suppose.
Yeah.
But like, I think most people, when they go through the App Store and they download something like Google, they see all the things that it's supposed to be communicating with, and they just go right through it. It's like the terms of service.
Well, Phil had to write that. Look, and they freak out because they don't understand it because it's not explained in plain.
Well, yeah, because you had to do like two or three explainers this year to say, no, don't panic. This is why.
I had to do it on when everybody freaked out about Facebook. Uh-huh. Facebook did nothing with its app that 500,000 other apps don't do as well. You know, why does this app need access to my camera? Because it can take pictures. You know, and I haven't used Windows Phone in a while, but in the early days, you would open up your camera, and the camera would say, hi, I want to use the camera. Can I use the camera? I'm the camera.
Yeah.
Yes, and quit asking. Yeah. So there are very different ways to go about that, and that's something I'd like to see Google address as well.
So, I mean, it's wonderful. CES, to me, is always like a graveyard for technology that didn't pan out, but also like the promise of what's to come, and I think this year is sort of the same. It's like wonderful things that almost are there. Is that a fair assessment?
Yeah, we're so like it's so early in terms of the entire year. Most people buy the gadgets they're going to buy around the holidays.
Right.
Yeah. So this is really just like a proving ground for what's going to be coming out. I think Mobile World Congress is going to be a great showcase for what's next in mobile. I think we're going to see great new
design. Is that the spring?
It'll be
late February.
Late February. Yeah.
No, it's actually early March this year, I think.
And early March.
It's a big show.
Yeah.
I think we're going to see a lot out of that.
This
show
is not reality here. Yeah. That's what we have.
Well, this is for buyers to show us what they're going to buy for us next year that we'll get in the holidays.
So. And Mobile World Congress is like that too, right?
Very much so.
They're glimpses of the future.
Yep.
All right. So, Mark, if people want to follow you, if they want to see all the stuff you're writing, where can they go?
Well, they can go to @mspoonhour or go to tomsguide.com or laptopmag.com.
Awesome. And you're going to be taking them every step of the way through all this stuff.
Yeah, that's right. We already have our Best of Show awards up for both sites, Laptop focusing mostly on mobile, and Tom's Guide everything from 4K TVs to drones to...
Not 4K drones.
Washing machines. 4K drones. Yeah. 4K washing machine.
4K washing machines.
Phil, where can they go for you?
Android Central, all our Mobile Nation sites. I pop on occasionally. I'm Phil Nickinson on all the social stuff.
Plus Phil Nickinson @PhilNickinson.
I'm pretty boring and use my name, yes.
Hello, Phil Nickinson. Yes. Anywhere you can find him. Dan, what about you?
I'll be at WindowsCentral.com as usual. And of course, I'm @Daniel_Rubino. How to get fancy with that. So on Twitter.
You can find me @ReneRitchie. You can find me @iMore.com. You can find our friends who are, you know, manning all the gear here at GeekBeat.tv. And I want to thank you guys for joining us because this to me is the most awesome stuff. We get to talk about technology every day. And we're not done yet because Daniel Rubino has refused to leave this stage. He is insisting that once a year you get a Windows Central podcast like clockwork. So don't go anywhere. But, you know, this is Dave. Are we back tomorrow, Dave? We're back tomorrow, so this is not over. We'll be back tomorrow with more CES Live. And that's that. And the quarterback is toast.
And I need a coffee.
Yeah.
God.
I was fighting some yawns.